Hey guys, welcome to another live broadcast brought to you by the Eastwood Company. Do the job right with Eastwood. Happy New Year, everybody. This is a lot of fun. 2015 is going to be an incredible year for not only the Eastwood Company, but for some paint education stuff that's coming down the pike. So I'm excited to show you all kinds of stuff. We're going to kick off a live stream today talking about tools. And as always, these will be available on YouTube later for later viewing. In case you missed, in case you got a buddy that wants to see some of the tools that we've showcased, let them know. And as always, down below your screen, there are links to where you can either look at or go ahead and buy the tools that we are showcasing here. What we're doing today is giving you an overview of some tools that aren't very expensive that are really, really nice accessories to the tools that you may already have, or they may be something that you want to add to your tool collection. Let's face it, we're all tool junkies. I have been collecting tools in my professional career for a long time, probably close to 30 years. And I've still got a lot of the tools that I started out with. And it's an accumulative process. You guys know this. You could never have enough tools. Tools have been part of mankind for about 2.6 million years, dating back to the Stone Age, where we figured out as knuckle-dragging idiots that we could sharpen stones and kill things with them. It's not something that is new. However, tools allow us to refine the process of doing work. And it's a beautiful thing to have the tool to do the job right the first time. The slogan here is do the job right. And so one of the cool things about the Eastwood Company that I like, there is an R&D team. You can go online, JR and Mark, Matt Murray, you'll see videos from me online talking about the tools that not only Eastwood sells, but Eastwood develops. We're a bunch of gearheads. We're just like you. And we take ideas and say, well, how can we build this better mousetrap? Well, you know, and then they do it. We do it. We go back and forth and we develop all kinds of cool stuff. So very exciting to be a part of the Eastwood Company, especially in 2015. So what we're going to do today is just kind of go around some must-have tools. And there are tools that I think that you just kind of must have. And throughout this broadcast, you can log in with your account and you can ask questions. You can ask, feel the questions in. I've got my little Captain Kirk Bluetooth device that at the end of this presentation, we will be answering your questions live. And it's just a real kind of a cool resource that Eastwood has developed. And you know, I'm not trying to sell you anything. I'm just trying to show you stuff. The truth is we have to buy tools. And Eastwood wants to sell you tools. But here's the difference. They also want to take it to the next level and sell you the tool and give you the education that it takes to be able to use the tools properly and have a successful operation the first time out. So that's what today's about. We're going to show you tools and we're going to tell you a little bit about how to use them. So we're going to start off with a MIG welder. This is a MIG 175. This is a great machine. It's got the guides on the back like every welder does. The thing I like about this welder particularly is it's got infinite controls. And the settings guide is seldom wrong. It operates with the 7525 shielding gas and it comes with an optional spool gun. I'm not trying to sell you a welder. There's an accessory on it that if you're doing restoration panel replacement, you're wanting to use rosette welds or plug welds to join pinched metal together. And cars that are assembled on a line using electric welders. Nobody's got a giant honking electric welder. A lot of guys, you know, some class acts like Roadster Shop, those guys have electric welders. Maybe some of you guys out there do, but I sure don't, and I've never had one. What I do is typically use a rosette weld. You punch a hole in one side, you have access to the last to the other side, and it takes a tool like this. It's a punch and a flange. If you don't have this tool, you're doing your rosette welds with this, and this is a lot of drilling. Well, here comes Eastwood, and they've got a spot weld kit. Look at the back side of that. Look at the heat affected zone. And here's how it works. You've got a set of proprietary pliers. You clamp down your workpiece. Wow. And that's a goofy, awkward angle. So basically what I'm going to do I'm going to ground it like so. Here's kind of the secret. It's a proprietary nozzle end the threads onto your MIG 175 or the smaller machine, you can see exactly what it does. It maintains a distance off of that substrate. It's brainless. It's really kind of cool. You stick it in there and you hammer home and you go. We're going to show you exactly how it works. I've got my shielding gas on. And I don't even know what the welder's set at, but we're going to. But we're going to give it a blast. All right, so we gave it a shot. Now on the front side of your weld, you're going to see that it's a really nice smooth pool. That can be dressed down, or it almost looks like a factory electric weld. But here's the magic. Look at the heat affected zone. Isn't that cool? Now you haven't drilled anything on the panel. All you've done is pinch them together. And whenever you drill, you expose an edge, you invite the metal to tear, you invite the fire to burn the metal, and I'll explain that some other time. But this, it's a really neat accessory, and it's just an add-on to your MIG 175 if you already had it. Here's another one. We're going to hang on the welder for a little bit. Modern dent repair and collision repair techniques dictate that you've got an electric stud welder. I've got an electric stud welder because I was a professional body man, and it was part of my tool arsenal. If you got a welder and you don't want to spend that couple hundred bucks on the electric stud welder to be able to pull dents out from the outside and not use the old school Swiss cheese, drill an eighth inch hole, put in your slide hammer, this is a really neat trick. There's a system, it's a nozzle add-on. It just screws in with a set screw to your MIG nozzle. And it goes back to the conventional nozzle on the MIG, which we're going to just thread on. Now this guy comes in. And I'm going to set standoff to about, well, so I've got about a quarter inch of stick out on my MIG wire. I'm gonna hit it with the set screw. Tighten it down just a taste. And here's the cool fun part. Well, I'm an idiot. The flared end goes down. I promise you this isn't as complicated, because you're going to set it up one time and then you're ready for however many studs that you want to install. Okay, so you can see what's going on there. There's a flat on the nozzle end and it maintains that perfect distance. And the MIG wire comes down and feeds it, and we're going to give it a shot. You see it sets the pin. Pay no attention to what that other giant spark was. So anyway, then you take your puller that comes with the kit, with the pins, and obviously roll it back. And now you can pull that dent out and you bypassed the expense of that expensive other tool, unless you absolutely want one. You don't have to have one. This is an inexpensive add-on. When you're done, cut your pins, grind everything flush, and move on to your fillers. It's a really cool system. Not very much money. Go to the website, check them out. They got crazy sales all the time. So here's another thing that's really, really quite simple. If you've ever worked with tubing, or round stock of any kind, and you've had to either drill and tap or drill a hole in it. So here's what happens sometimes. You get your drill, you can mark your hole, you can even countersink, you can hit it with a center punch. Sometimes it just rolls. Not good. This is a stupid simple device. It's a V-block, it's a drill press fixture. You set your round stock in there and you're having a really hard time rolling that stuff. It's just one of those things. It sets it up perfectly for a drill press or freehand drilling. And again, inexpensive, very nice device. So drill press block, great. All right, if you do, I'm allergic to mechanical work. Ryan Shand will tell you this. I reluctantly do what little I know actually how to do. But sometimes you just need things like a torque wrench. And Eastwood has their own line of torque wrenches. This is the one that I've got. It's a half-inch drive wrench, and it goes from 50 to 250 foot-pounds. It's got a nice long throw, so where you don't have to put a breaker bar on the outside. The adjustments are easy to read, even for failing eyes like mine, and it's just a nice device. It's got a pullback where you can make your adjustment, and it locks in when you've released the coupler. They also have a 3/8 torque wrench and I've got my specs here, and it reads from 50 to 250 inch-pounds. So 3/8 drive, of course it's smaller, but if you're setting, like for instance, Project Z sled up there on the lift, we were setting the drag on the pinion bearing and needed an inch-pound torque wrench, and that sucker comes in really handy for stuff like that. Here's the other cool thing about it. Typical torque wrenches, the older technology torque wrenches, dictate that you have to zero them out before you throw it into, before you throw it back in the case, back in the drawer, in the toolbox. These have a different design spring to where you don't have to zero it out. Prudence will probably tell you that you want to zero it out anyways, but you don't have to, and it won't mess up your calibration if you don't. Typically, I will go ahead and zero it out anyways just because I'm stuck in that old school mentality, but you don't have to. It's a really nice feature of the newer Eastwood torque wrenches. So that's in your Rolodex as well. Very nice tools to have. If you're replacing an intake manifold, I've done a head swap on an older car that I had. It was years ago. It was a 67 Fairlane, and I threw aluminum Edelbrock heads on it. And I'm not a mechanic, but I can read a torque spec and follow a torque sequence if it's on a piece of paper in front of me. Without a torque wrench, I wouldn't have been able to do that. So it may seem like a luxury at some point, but it'd make a great Christmas gift. You know what I'm saying? Okay. Here's something else. Now, I'm a paint and body guy. Automotive restoration, the number one enemy of old cars is rust. Rust, it's oxidation. Everything rusts. Rust is the chemical reaction between a substrate, either aluminum, steel, plastic, paint, and the oxygen and the atmosphere around it. It's a chemical reaction where one hits the other and they mix into really bad stuff in between. In the case of steel, it's iron oxide, it's oxidation, it's rust, and it's a contamination based on moisture and acid and all kinds of bad stuff in the air that hits that steel, that unprotected steel, and causes it to look like that. That's really poopy. It's not good at all. It's rusty. And here's my point. I know I'm going babbling on and on about this stuff, but as rusty as that is on the outside, well, it's easy to surface prep that. We can use chemicals, I can use grinders, I can use fiber discs, I can use sandpaper, heck, I could lick most of that rust off. But, camera guy Steve is laughing at me, I'm not gonna lick the rust off. But the inside of that is probably rusty too. So if you've got a valuable old car and you've prepped the frame, you've shot the frame, what are you doing to the inside? If you've got internal coatings or blind areas that you can't, like a captured area between a wheelhouse and a quarter panel, you can't get in there to prep it, what are you gonna do? There's a really interesting coating system that Eastwood has. They call it their internal frame coating. There's a couple of different ways to apply it. We've got aerosol here. It comes in mixed quartz as well. The heavy-duty anti-rust has been in the Eastwood product line for a long time. It's similar to the old Z-Bart coatings in that it's waxy and it coats areas that you can't get access to and stops the oxygenating process. It literally seals it in. It stops it from rusting. So you can apply these with typical methods, with a Schutz gun, with a wand, or even with spray guns. But here's the cool thing. With the aerosol, they've got a proprietary nozzle that... by the way, it comes in black and green. I'm going to try not to spray the camera, but you can see what happens here. Look at that nozzle. It fans out. I'll do one more time. So if you want to, for instance, the subframe on Zed Sled, we did a lot of work. I can't show it to you because it's up on the lift. We did a lot of work prepping that subframe, and... and making sure it looked beautiful from the top side, but nothing happened on the bottom. Well, guess what? This is going to happen. So I've got my internal frame coating here, and I'm just basically just dragging this sucker through. Well, that made a heck of a mess everywhere, but you know my point. You'd run that through there a couple of times, and we'll make sure nothing's sticking out the back of it. But you see what happens. It's an aggressive nozzle, and it's gonna coat the internal passages of either a frame rail or there's even, you know, high temp coatings. You can do exhaust tubing and headers and stuff like that. It's a really neat idea. It's an excellent way to not lose sleep over what's happening on the inside. When we restore these vehicles, they're not ours. We are the stewards of these vehicles, and it's our responsibility to pass them on in better shape than we found them to the next guy that's going to care for them. We're here for a relatively short time. Vehicles, they can be here for hundreds of years if we do them right. And internal frame coating, that's a way to make sure the legacy of these cool vehicles that we're working on, or heck, any kind of a metal project, lives beyond you, lives beyond the project that you're doing. So internal frame coating definitely has a place. And in my opinion, if you're doing a restoration, it's a must-have. It's spray cans have gotten a reputation of being lesser quality. And the convenience outweighs that sometimes. Sometimes it's so convenient just to grab a rattle can and spray a bracket down, or spray a fan blade down, or do a small project like an axle housing. And so you reach for, rather than get out the compressor, run your air lines, mix your paint up, get into a pneumatic spraying situation with a bunch of overspray for a tiny, tiny project. Sometimes it can take you twice as long to clean up as it even does to spray the thing. So I'm belaboring this because I want to give the example of why we reach for spray cans sometimes when we really should be using a professional catalyzed coating system. Well, Eastwood has figured out how to do both with one. It's called 2K Aerospray. It's a fantastic innovation. High temp ceramic engine paint. Here's how this stuff works. You've got a button on the top. It's on the can. Pull it out, and here, there's a ball that rattles. See this guy right here? That little push button thing. You put your cap in there, and with the heel of your hand, pop that sucker. I'm not going to do it because I don't want to waste this can of paint. Pop that down, you'll hear it break, and then you intermix it. What it does is release catalyst into this spray can. And now you've got a professional coating in a spray can. And it's a beautiful thing because it's every bit as catalyzed as your high-end pneumatic systems. And typically, these run about $25 a can. As far as coverage goes, I did the entire axle housing, 3 fat coats on a GM 10-bolt rear axle. It looks gorgeous, and I did it with 1 can. I used every bit of it, but I did 3 fat coats of paint on that axle housing. Okay, this is live, and I forgot to turn my phone off. Hang on. Focus on something other than me, Steve. All right, I'm back, and I'm an idiot, so sorry for that. I silenced my cell phone, but I didn't sign the shop phone here. And I'm sure it was some crazy telemarketer wanting to let me know that I just won a free trip to the Bahamas. But anyway, so 2K Aerospray comes in all kinds, and they just released the high-temp ceramic engine paint. Now, look down here. I've got epoxy and the 2K engine paint on the LS 6-liter that's going in Zed Sled. Now, this puppy is going to be pushing somewhere close to 500 horse. We don't know exactly which. Dyno tuning will tell us for sure, but it's going to be a stout engine. With engine comes heat. The high-heat paint is perfect, and this stuff looks great, and it was easy to apply. I used the primer, and then with the paint over top of it, this is the process. You've got your prep steel, a true 2K epoxy primer, not just some rattle can thing that looks like a primer, and here we've got a semi-gloss black, similar to restoration colors, similar to OE stuff. This is actually a Mustang battery tray, and this is almost exactly what Ford used on a lot of their internal stuff. also got a flat black that has a little bit different hue. If you look at a properly restored antique Ford, there's three or four different shades or different glosses of black, different colors of black. And this, it just really makes a very nice job. So now, you can pop the seal in your rattle can. In your rattle can and have a professional coating system. Yes, you still have to use safety equipment. You got a glove up and you got a mask and all that kind of stuff. But you've got a spray pattern about this wide, you've got minimal overspray, you've got a $25 setup, and sometimes you can't touch that, especially in red colors with the big pneumatic spray applications. 2K Aero Spray has a lot of different benefits, and they're coming out with new products on a daily basis, new colors. They've got the Rat Rod Black colors. They've got a matte clear that exactly matches the Rat Rod Flat Clear in the big mixing gallons or quarts. And it's a beautiful coating. Here's the other kicker. When you mix paint into a cup, you've got, depending on the temperature, anywhere from 45 minutes, sometimes less, to possibly a 2 or 3 hour pot life. What pot life is once you add that catalyst into your mix, that's the amount of time that it's still gonna remain a liquid and that it doesn't kick. By kick, I mean start to cross-link and change and turn to jello. Not good. If it's a 100 degree day, like sometimes it gets here in Middle Tennessee, 100 degree day, if you've got an hour pot life, that shrinks to about 30 minutes. If you've got a 45-minute pot life, well, your pot life on that product is now about 15 minutes. Well, if it takes you 45 minutes to get around a vehicle, you can see what's happening there. Here's the interesting thing, and it's the last thing I'm going to babble about with the 2K Aero Spray. You have got a 48-hour pot life at the moment you crack the seal. So what I do is write the time and the date on the side of the can when I crack the seal. 2 days later, I can use this. So I'm not wasting it. If I've got to paint a bracket and I'm not going to be ready for some control arms until the next day, or if I need some more time to prep some stuff because I've still got some paint left, I can leave this for 48 hours. And it's going to be perfectly usable and give the same effect, the same beauty, the same coating, the same mill thickness, the same quality 2K professional coating as it did the moment I cracked the seal. And I'm not really supposed to tell you this, but just like with your conventional paint systems, if you cool them down, it slows down the cross-linking. And if you take this, throw it in the refrigerator, it's going to extend that pot life even more. The reason it's got such an extended pot life is because it's sealed. There's no oxygen coming into this. There's nothing creating an oxygenation effect onto the catalyzed equipment. So it's sealed from the atmosphere. So that lets it remain in a non-cross-linked state until it actually sprays out the nozzle and becomes a different product. I want to show you the different nozzle. This is the one last thing. Here's a very cool thing. This is the primer. Primer needs a larger orifice. That's one of the big things about small delivery systems. This has actually got a fan control on the top, and I'm not going to spray it out because, again, it'll ruin the coating, or it'll use it. But this guy with the primer gives you the option to dial in to about that width and then about a 3-inch wide pattern just with the adjustable cap. Some of the other ones, like the paint colors, they've got a nice wide pattern, about almost 2.5-inch pattern that gives you a lot of versatility and a very smooth coating, but it's not adjustable. However, it's well done. Like I said, these guys are about $25 a can, and new colors are coming out every day. It's a beautiful thing to be able to utilize this and create the professional work that you want in an environment that, well, that quite frankly is a non-professional environment. Let's face it, most of us are weekend warriors. I've had the privilege of working in some really interesting shops, working alongside craftsmen that I've learned a lot from. I've worked a lot in television along people that know a lot more than me. And sometimes the environment that you're working in is compromised. Sometimes you get in a rush. 2K Aero Spray, can't say enough about it. I use it, I don't have to. But I do, and it's a great product. So again, awesome stocking stuffer. $25 a can, you can't go wrong. Of course, the prices are gonna fluctuate, but you'll find that when you go to eastwood.com. If you have a plasma cutter, there's something I want you to look at. Cutting with a plasma torch freehand sometimes doesn't yield the best results. If you don't have a plasma cutter, I strongly urge you to check out the VersaCut line from Eastwood. I've got the 60 here. It's a honking cutter. Now, I'm going to talk about the accessory just in a second, but I want to talk about the VersaCut 60. Look at this table. This is half-inch plate. This is a giant honking table. This was sitting outside of my shop, and I had no idea what to do with this. I knew I had to do something with this big half-inch steel plate, and the best solution was to make a giant tabletop out of it. Heck, this is flat. You're not going to bend a half-inch plate. This could be a chassis jig. So it had to be a table. So now I've got my Eastwood equipment bolted down to the table, and it's a great platform, and I can work off of it, and I can store stuff on it. I've got toolbox casters on it. It's a great table. It's a homemade table. When I mounted the equipment on here, if I had used drills to get down through this half-inch plate, not only would I have just waxed out a whole bunch of batteries, it would have taken me forever to drill out mounting holes for all my equipment. With the VersaCut 60, it went through half-inch plate in about 2.5 seconds. I'm not kidding. It just blew holes through here. It was a lot of fun, and it's a great machine. This machine is rated to 7/8 thickness on the highest settings. And it may take you a while to cut 7/8, but it's rated for that on the duty cycle. It's a nice machine. So, we'll talk about control. Here's your wand. To freehand a plasma torch, if you've ever used one, it's difficult because you got a mask on, you got gloves on, and you're kind of guessing because it's dark until you hit it and you strike the arc, and sometimes it can be goofy. If you're in a compromised position, sometimes you can make a mess. Well, here's a neat idea. This is a roll of magnet. What it is, it's a fence. Typically, if I want to make a straight cut here, I'll take a piece of angle iron or square tubing or something like that, clamp it on either side, and drag my torch down on the other side. However, with this, it's magnetic. The cool thing about it is that I can straighten it out and I can get a nice straight cut, or I can draw it around just like you draw around pinstriping tape. And now, I've got a beautiful arc there to do my plasma cut. So I take my wand, and I'm getting a perfect cut. First time. Again, it's the little things. Actually, that's what my wife says, but this is a neat accessory if you've got a plasma torch. And it's one of those inexpensive things. You gotta have it. It's a must have. When you're building a car, or building components of a car. Let's say you're doing a restoration and you realize that you got to rebuild the brake system. It's a car that's been sitting for 35 years and it's in great shape and everything looks good from the outside. Your brake cylinders, especially on the old Fords, they just weep. So you're better off replacing all of that stuff. A lot of times it's just not worth taking a chance with your life on brake lines. The pain in the butt that comes with that is having to make new brake lines. That's one of those things where it's just, I don't know, it's become a lot easier. And one of the ways that it's become easier is the accessibility of the line kits, the nuts. For instance, I got this line kit from Eastwood, 3/16 line. It's going to be the brake system on Zed-Sled. It comes like this just because of the fact that this is how you ship it. And it's steel line, it's not stainless steel, it's mild steel. So it's boxed up and it's UPSable rather than having it be in long straight cartons and have it be truck freight. So that's a beautiful thing. So where this becomes a pain in the butt is when you try and straighten it out, it's awkward. And what you typically end up with is a line like that. Now you can go back and forth and you can spend a lot of time trying to straighten that out. And that's when a line straightening kit comes in. There's some on the market that are quite expensive. And then there's this guy. This is a really, really neat little tool. It looks, I don't know, does it look like a sandwich? I don't know, what does it look like? It's basically what it is, it's one of these guys. Between these rollers and these rollers on the outside end, it straightens the line. The peanut gallery can talk about the application all they want to here. And you know who I'm talking about, Rob. So within a few seconds, I've taken that gnarly looking thing to a perfectly straight line. And this guy is less than $100. This is a must have. You gotta have this if you're ever gonna work with tubing. And it's just a gorgeous thing to have. Along with your nut kit, all that kind of stuff. There's also bending pliers. This is just a handheld set of bending pliers. And you can go and you can create really tight radius with these guys. And the fact that camera guy Steve's gonna get real close here, you can see the channel. These are curved. And if you take your time, you can make really nice bends without kinking your line. Very necessary. Here's another. Again, if you're doing complex bends, a line bender like this allows you to make bends like that easily without kinking. This is your brake system, guys. A line straightening tool or a line bender or the bending pliers right here. This is important stuff, and it allows you to do it safely and keep that pneumatic or that fluid pressure in without kinking those lines. If you tried to bend that freehand, then I think you'd be in trouble, and you're going to compromise the safety of your vehicle. So, beautiful thing. Once you get your brake lines done, and this is something I'm springing on the guys at Eastwood, but this is something I work by myself a lot, and it's not because I don't have any friends. It's because sometimes I just find myself working on projects by myself. I call it therapy. When I was building Jaded, I used to say to my wife, I said, I'm going to go and do Mustang therapy, and I'd spend a half a day at the shop and just either block panels or design stuff or whatever. So I work by myself a lot. I'm sure you guys work by yourself a lot too. Our cars, our weekend projects, sometimes it's just nice to forget about everything else and focus on something else. Part of the problem about working by yourself is the fact that you're working by yourself. And, you know, the whole two-guy method of bleeding brakes, pump it up, hold it, yep, go ahead. You know, that communication of grunts and groans between two grown men bleeding out a brake system is not, it's something that's not uncommon. This saves you from having to do that. It's a complete, there's a pressure gauge, it's a complete system. You can bleed off the top of the caliper, just like the picture says. It's vacuum controlled, and it's lots of adapter fittings. It's a nice way to continue working by yourself and still get a good bleed on your brake system, and you know, it gets you one day closer to actually driving your project. So, having said that, this is all for sale. All of these tools are for sale on the Eastwood website. I'm going to show you some stuff that you either have already or is not going to cost you hardly anything. Now, this is free stuff. I call it free because I've got this stuff all over the place. This is dishwashing liquid. Soap, you got to have soap. This cuts the surface tension of your sanding water if you're color sanding or if you're prepping. It's a high pH, so it's acidic. It's designed to cut grease in your sink for your kitchen dishes that are dirty. And it's going to do the same thing if you're prepping a car. You want to give it one final wash, get all that wax and Armor-All and stuff off the outside. This, you got to have it. Car wash doesn't work for washing cars, for prepping for paint. Get some of this stuff. It's a buck. Ajax. I'm not really supposed to say brand names, but this is, it doesn't matter. Ajax is a metaphor for abrasive powdery cleaner. Using an abrasive powdery cleaner on a scuffing pad, getting that wet, that is a really fine abrasive, and it's also a very, very good cleaning agent. And when you're working on late model cars with the urethane fascias, having something like this, give it that extra bit of clean. Not only is it a little bit more grit that falls in between the actual fibers of your scuffing pad and gets you a more thorough scuff, it also does a secondary duty as a cleaner. And guess what it cost? A buck. A pair of scissors. Why do I have scissors in a body shop? Why do I have it in a mechanic shop? I cut everything from masking tape to masking paper to sandpaper, even 36 grit rolls of paper. If I want to cut it off and have a nice clean line at the end of my sanding board, ka-chunk, guess what they cost? a buck. Foaming glass cleaner. This, we all need a glass cleaner. We got a detail, we got to clean. I use this as a cleaner. If I'm going to sand a panel, if I'm prepping and enhancing a surface after it's been painted, I'm using a foaming glass cleaner on it because of a couple of different reasons. I want it clean. It's a wet cleaner. I come back with a microfiber rag come back and clean this. It does a very nice job cleaning. It's an organic cleaner. You got two types of contamination. There's solvent-based and there's organic-based. So you got to do a wipe down with solvent and you got to do an organic cleaner if you're going to be thoroughly clean for your paint booth. And this also has alcohol in it that causes it to evaporate quickly. So alcohol is a natural anti-static. I've got isopropyl alcohol in the 75-25 ratio that I get from the drugstore as a final wipe down if I'm ever doing fiberglass or plastic, because those parts have a cling to them as well. And I'm getting a call. I think we got some questions coming in. Yeah, this is Kevin. Hey, Matt. So, let me finish up with a cleaner here. But this has got alcohol in it, so it's an anti-stat as well. I keep alcohol in the booth, and I use this all the time. This is a dollar egg timer. Oh, yeah, guess what this cost? A dollar. This is a quick and dirty. Aluminum foil works in a couple of different ways. But the biggest thing, if I've got to do a quick masking job, and I'm going to paint my cart, and I don't want to paint the handle, here's where aluminum foil comes in. I didn't have to whip out a $7 roll of masking tape. And I've got a nice crisp edge, precision edge there. My handle's there. I can paint my cart, and I can pull that guy off of there. And things like brake pedals, clutch pedals, under the dash, under the hood. If you're painting an edge of compartment, there's hard to find areas. Aluminum foil is a nice thing to have around in your shop. 2 points. And guess what it cost? It costs a buck. We want to sell you stuff, but we want you to have success. So stuff like this is nice to pass on. So Matt's got some questions for me on the other end up in Pottstown, Pennsylvania. Matt? If you could... the question was, can somebody use the spot welding kit if you're using a clamp such as in floorboards? And Matt, correct me if I'm wrong, but my answer to that is yes. Here's the thing. Spot weld kit doesn't work with a hill of beans if you're doing a butt weld. It has to be an overlap, and you've got to have enough material there to do a successful overlap. Sometimes in a restoration, that doesn't look OE. That looks like a floor patch has been put in there. However, if you've got a pinch weld on your floor pan that you're utilizing, or a shelf, or an underbody bracket, yes, you can. And I just showed you how, and your MIG comes in, bam, hit it. With different thicknesses, such as a floor pan, sometimes you're dealing with 18 gauge metal, which is, that's what this is here. This is 20. So you want to always test out your welds. What was that? Test out your welds on some practice pieces of similar thicknesses of the metal. So you make sure, if you do it on a panel, you're not pressed up upside down, working on floor pans, welding upside down, whatever. Do it on a test panel first. Make sure that you've got this on the back side. You want your heat affected zone absolutely crystal clear on the backside. You want that little dimple because that shows that these two pieces are now fused into one piece at that point, at that critical point. So yes, the question was, can you use this spot weld thing on a floor pan? Yes, you can. Where I really like to use this is in a pinch weld of a door, because it looks like the factory electric welds. So you can use it for structural. Make sure you're getting your penetration and your heat affected zone on both sides of the panel so you're not doing a cold weld. And we all know what a cold weld is. It's a bad weld. So thanks for that question. Anything else, Matt? Yeah. Excellent, excellent question. The question was, when you're using a plasma cutter, Would I prefer to use an electric shear to get a nice clean cut, or would I prefer to use a plasma cutter? And the answer to that is absolutely in the application. If I'm dealing with flat stock here, I'm probably going to trace out a line, set my shear, and weld it, and cut it with the electric shear or a pneumatic shear. Or if I've got a metal brake, which I don't, which I want one, I can sit it in, stomp it, and I'm cut. Where the plasma torch comes in handy is if I want to do it quickly. I can set this up, I can set my fence, or my magnetic guide, fire my cutter up, and I can zip it down probably as fast as I can with plugging in the electric shear and actually making the cut that way, tracing it out, scribing it out, having a guideline, all that kind of stuff. The difference is, with a plasma cutter, you've got essentially, well, here, I'll show it to you. This area right here that's kind of cruddy, essentially you've got that all along the edge of your plasma cut. And I wish I had a piece that had been cut with a plasma torch, and I'm gonna hunt just in case. And I don't, but basically that causes something that you have to dress down. So the difference is that the quality of cut with an electric shear is gonna be cleaner, and with a plasma torch, you're gonna have to dress that edge just a little bit. However, you're not gonna be able to get an electric shear in an inner wheelhouse. When I did the mini tubs on Jaded, we went inboard about probably 4 inches just to get that stupid wide tire on the backside without flaring outside, without using shackles to get it up off the ground. I wanted a little ride height. So you mini tub. So you cut your wheelhouses on the inside. I would not have been able to do that. I literally went in with a plasma cutter and cut out around the separation between the outer wheelhouse and the inner wheelhouse, which goes towards the inside of the trunk. And I carved that sucker out in about, probably 15 minutes aside, I had the tubs cut. You're not gonna do that with an electric shear. So there's the big difference there. The convenience of this guy makes up for the little bit of extra prep work that you've got on your edges. If this is exposed, if you're gonna see this after it's done, I would absolutely use a electric shear or some other type of cutting device to make a nice clean cut like that. Or you're gonna have to dress it down. So I hope that answers a question and maybe gives a couple of examples of how to use both of those pieces of gear and how they can work for you. Mm-hmm. Okay, interesting question. It's relating to 2K Aerospray. And I've got some of the self-etching. Are you talking about weld-through primer, Matt? Okay, so the question is, some people prefer a self-etching primer, and 2K Aerospray has an epoxy primer. What's my preference, and where would I use each one? Well, for instance, we've got aluminum substrate here. Aluminum oxidizes really quickly, and a lot of late model vehicles use galvanized sheet metal. In the replacement sheet metal, you've got a galvanized coating on there. Galvanizing is a sacrificial coating. It rusts way sooner than your substrate's going to rust, and it thereby takes the attention off the mild steel and allows you to have those panels last a lot longer because the galvanized coating takes the heat. So in the instance of aluminum, not always, but aluminum and galvanized coatings and I would say different substrates, like maybe not necessarily a mild steel, but I guess more in the case of aluminum. The etching primers have an acid content in them, and that will give you extra adhesion. That will give you bite onto something that might have been sitting, might have be an oxidized coating like a galvanized coating. It gives you a little bit of extra adhesion in the sense that it's kind of referred to as a tie coating. But it gives you a little bit extra bite onto that substrate. It's an acid etch that then you can coat either wet on wet or sanded application. The epoxy you kind of have to know that your surface is freshly prepped and that it's really clean and that it's ready for a coating. Having said that, epoxy is glue. It sticks to anything and anything sticks to it. There are some rules, but if your coating is prepped properly, epoxy works extremely well on aluminum and just about any mild steel substrate. Here's the difference too, and it comes down to a preference. If you're using a acid etch primer on a flexible part, or a part that's gonna take some movement, like a hinge spring, or even a plastic or urethane fascia, the etching primers sometimes aren't as flexible. They are not as malleable once they cure out. That's where epoxies come in. So my preference for plastic parts is always clean it off very well and then go with an epoxy on there. So that's where I would prefer to use this, specifically over top of an etch primer. And if that seems like I'm all over the place, I'm trying to draw examples out from where I've used both, and I think that gives you a pretty decent idea of where you would use both. But an etch primer, like I said, it's an acid content in that primer, and it gives you a little bit extra bite onto a surface that may be compromised or maybe like a sacrificial galvanized coating. So hopefully that answers that question. Okay. As always, we want to bring you what you want to see. We want to show you stuff that can help you. We want to accentuate the experience of doing this stuff. We want to sell you tools, but we want to, you know, give you the power and the empowerment to have a successful experience the first time out. That's my goal with Patrucation and the instructional videos that and the online coaching that I do as well. We want you to have success right out of the gate. And things like this, the Eastwood Online Restoration Forum, even the Hands on Cars shows. Watch Hands on Cars on YouTube. We just posted episode number 8, and it's a lot of fun. We go to Brian Finch's place and beat his Camaro to death and see what he's got working on. We do an Elastie Wrap paint job. The resources that we put out there are educational tools. They don't cost you anything. It doesn't cost you anything to get online and watch this stuff. So please go and take advantage of those resources. Like I said, 2015 is going to be an incredible year, and we're very excited about it. I'm particularly excited about it because we've got some new training guides coming out, and we'll talk about that a little closer to the mark. There's new spray guns coming out. There's a turbine system. There's a lot of stuff that we're going to walk you through the process of. We're going to show you how to do this stuff. And the mantra for everybody at Eastwood, down to the people that take your tech calls or take your sales calls, everybody's gearheads there, and everybody wants to help do the job right. That's our slogan, is do the job right. So on that note, thank you so much for tuning into this live stream. Check us out online, eastwood.com, for sales on tools and equipment that we've shown you today, as well as in past live streams, as well as they've got new tools coming in almost on a monthly basis. There's lots to see on the Eastwood website. We've got the Shop Talk podcasts, interviews of really interesting people over the last couple of years. There's 30-some-odd podcasts on there, just really interesting interviews from different people that we met out at SEMA and stuff like that. Lots of resources. It doesn't cost you a thing. Like these guys here. It doesn't have to cost a lot of money. And the last thing I want to say about tools is you've got a massive tool, and I'm not referring to Carson Daly, although that's been said publicly, so that's not my thing. The tool between your ears is the most important tool that you could ever have. So cultivate that sucker. Use common sense, work safely, live to spray another day is what I like to say. But, you know, the fun thing about all this stuff is that it's problem solving. Hot rodding is problem solving, period. Car restoration, there's a problem, here's a solution, here's the execution. So utilize this giant tool between your ears and have fun with it and let us help. Thank you to Eastwood, and we will be talking to you soon. Watch for more live streams coming up, and in the meantime, check out eastwood.com. Thanks, guys.